What is up, everybody? Ryan Parasoul here with the Occupational Memers. This is Overtalks, Episode 2, the Patch 1.04 follow-up. So last time we did these, we talked about just sort of analyzed the patch notes and talked about our initial thoughts on how the meta would be impacted. And this time we're going to be doing a follow-up now that we've actually played the patch for a significant amount of time. So anyway, who do I got here with me? Zathi, what's going on, dude?
Nothing much. How about you?
Hanging in there. Just got out of work, so pretty tired, but excited to do this. And how about you, Aura? What's up?
Not much. Just thinking, sleeping, dreaming over what.
There you go. That's what I like to hear. Let's get right into this. How about just some general thoughts on 1.04? Like, how are we liking this patch? Do we think they did a good job?
I'd say it was an overall success.
Yeah, I think I agree. We weren't really expecting how like drastically the meta would be changed. Like, a lot of stuff was changed. A lot of like hero placements, like low tiers went up, high tiers went down. Not just Widow and McCree. So it's pretty exciting. What are you thinking, Matt? Are you gonna say something?
The meta definitely shifted a lot from just two nerfs.
Exactly. That's something we were talking about yesterday, is just two nerfs, which were significant, but still only two characters out of, what, 26? Or 21?
21.
Yeah, 21. Yeah. Two characters got nerfed, and I feel like almost every character, except for a few, changed positions fairly significantly. So, let's just start with McCree. We talked about this last time, but he got nerfed. His damage on his right click got nerfed. It got a slight buff to the reload time, but overall it was a pretty significant nerf. How do we feel about McCree? Is he strong?
He is balanced now.
He's balanced now.
Yeah, his nerfs have definitely created a lot of ripples over, like, who is going to take the role as, like, the DPS character in teams now.
Absolutely.
And we've definitely seen, like, surges of soldiers and reapers, and surprisingly, as I may have said last episode...
Oh, we'll get to this.
Roadhog.
We'll get to that for sure. Roadhog has been, he's been going whole hog in the tier list. So McCree's balance, though, he's still strong. If we look at his play rate, he's still sitting at a pretty healthy 50% play rate, which honestly is like right where you want a character, right? They're played like about half the time. That's on the high end. It's definitely on the high end, I guess. But I mean, he's a strong ish character, but he is by no means overbearing, which he used to be absolutely overbearing. So,
for sure, he still like fills the role of like getting Genjis and Tracers and the extra mobile, hard to fight characters. So
can we all co-sign on the McCree nerfs as a success? Blizzard's plan, Blizzard's idea of McCree, and the nerfs that they applied to him were successful in what they wanted to accomplish.
Definitely a success.
I get my seal of approval.
Cool. Now, the next one, I think we might have more to say. Widow. Last time, if we look at her nerfs, her base damage went down on body shots from 150 to 120 at full charge. 15 to 12 is the base damage change. Headshot multiplier went up, so that she does more damage. She does equal damage on headshots. Her ult charge was increased, the time it takes to charge her ult, and then the quick scoping, unscoping animation thing that we talked about last time, essentially, she has a slower rate of fire unless she hard scopes. So, how do we feel about Widow? Is Widow good?
A lot of people have been thinking that Widow is balanced, and the other group of people are thinking she's over nerfed.
Yeah, nobody is thinking she's still really strong, though.
Yeah.
Like, I'll point that out. I've got a lot to say on her, but Alex, do you have anything? Because you're the biggest anti-Widowmaker person here, so...
That's true. I feel like I can see both sides. Like, I feel like she is more balanced, but there is a possibility that things could have gone a bit too far.
Yeah. If we look at some data, I'll link we'll link Planet Overwatch, which is the meta reports that I look at. I think they're extremely accurate. We'll link them in the description. But Widowmaker's play rate or play percentage dropped by. Let me get this right. It dropped by far the most, over double McCree. She dropped by 60%. Last week, she was played About she's played about 80% of the time, and this week she was not even quite 20% of the time. So that is a huge drop. That is from that is insane how much she was not played, and this is only accounting for like pretty high level teams here. So
actually a crazy
that is
crazy
a huge number. That is so big. That is like, if we were going to compare this to League, that would be like a champion's win rate dropping from like 58 to like 45 in one patch. Like, that's an equal comparison, I think.
Yeah, it's insane.
It's absurd. Yeah, it's crazy. Which, granted, her play rate was way too high last patch. She was played every single game, almost every single team comp. She was so oppressive, and everybody hated her. Unless you were playing her, then you probably had a lot of fun, but... She's down in the dumps this week. So
she feels so clunky now.
She feels clunky, man. It's the quick scoping thing for sure. That's the biggest thing. And I don't do we think that they should like buff her back at all? Is that something that we think we want to happen?
That's a really hard question because she dances such a fine line.
She does, absolutely. You even mentioned yesterday hitscan snipers just have the tendency to be really toxic.
Yeah, and it's true. They're insanely polarizing.
Insanely polarizing.
Like,
yeah.
You'll either have one that does nothing, or you'll have one that can carry the game because the accuracy is so on point.
Yeah. I'll say if they do buff her back, what they should do is just improve the amount of time, or increase the time that it takes, decrease the time that it takes for her to scope in and scope out. So that's really the only issue that I have. But if they don't buffer back, I think that it'll be fine. It'll just, Overwatch will become a game that's not dominated by snipers. Some FPSs are, some FPSs aren't. It's fine if it's not, you know?
And I do feel like going forward, whether she gets buffed or she doesn't get buffed, as players like recover from the shock of like the nerves and like learn how to play the new Widowmaker, she might become
better.
Yeah, we might see more play from her.
Absolutely. One thing that I do want to mention is part of the reason, not the entire reason, but a part of the reason why the Widowmaker's play rate dropped so significantly is because Widowmaker's play rate dropping a little sort of multiplies upon itself, making it drop even more. And what I mean by that is the best counter to a Widowmaker is another Widowmaker. So if the enemy team's not playing Widowmaker, you're not going to play Widowmaker because you don't need to counter the enemy's Widow. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So therefore, yeah, like, she loses two games that she's not played instead of one there. Whereas a character like McCree, you know, it doesn't work like that. Like, the hardest counter to McCree is not McCree pre-patch. It was Widow. Mm-hmm. So. That's just something to keep in mind. She's definitely down in the dumps on in terms of play percentage, if we want to just go off that. But have you guys played her much, at least in the past few weeks? I played her a lot. Either of you guys played her?
I've played her a few games. All I can really say is that she just really feels clunky now. I don't have as much fun as I used to playing her.
Yeah. I played her. I've been playing her a lot still. I still like her, but you definitely... I said this last podcast, and I'm, like, quadrupling down onto this point. You cannot play Widowmaker the entire game on every map anymore. You have to switch. If things start going bad, you gotta switch, because she just doesn't work on every point of every map. So
yeah,
no more Widow one tricks in the world. Learn other characters. But yeah, anything else we want to say about Widow and McCree, just in specific, before we start talking about all the other ripples that happened after this this stone was thrown into the pond?
I think we covered it all. I want to talk about how Genji is kind of replacing Widow.
Okay, yeah, let's start with Genji then. So, just in terms of heroes that have risen and fallen, Genji, what's Genji doing right now?
He's doing it all with style.
He's doing it all with style, and he's making it look good, too, especially if your name is Siegel. He's making it look really good.
Like, if you just have a player of that skill on your team playing Genji,
yep,
you can't go wrong.
Genji is very similar to current Widow and pre-patch Widow in the sense that if there is a player who is talented enough at this video game that we play called Overwatch to completely master him, he will dominate a game, absolutely. You know what I mean? which is awesome. I love characters like that. That's why I mained Widow before the patch. So, and I play a ton of Genji too. I love Genji. He's probably my third favorite character in the game.
He does the same job as Widow. He just is a little bit different.
Yeah, he assassinates the Mercy. He assassinates Lucio. Assassinates like Junkrat and snipers and those squishy targets that you need to get rid of to push up.
Definitely a lot more risky for him too.
Yeah, well, he actually has to use his body. And while Widow has to not. She's quite
the... I think that also creates, like, interesting gameplay. Is, like,
it does.
He's in the fray. You have to, like, track him down in the middle of your team. Not just standing off in the distance, like, oh, yeah. Got the medic.
Widow is definitely the assassin who has absolutely no risk to herself whatsoever, except for the enemy Widow. Whereas Genji is the assassin who has an enormous amount of risk if he messes up one double jump or accidentally shifts into a box and only goes an inch forward instead of the full distance, you know, or so many little things you can mess up on Genji, which is why I'm perfectly okay with him being very strong, which he is strong. He is certainly strong right now. I think the McCree nerfs combined with the Widow nerfs helped him a lot because, like, Widow being nerfed gave him a role to fill, and then McCree being nerfed was, like, his hardest counter, one of his hardest counters being taken away. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
So it's multiplicative.
I've been, like, playing with some McCree, like, after the patch, and I've actually had trouble dealing a Genji and with my stun right-click combo. Like, he might just mash out Reflect and actually
just kill you back.
Prevent me from killing him.
Yeah, totally. I've even had that on Tracer. I'm going to be talking a lot about Tracer tonight, probably, but I've even had that on Tracer multiple times where McCree stuns me, and if he's not, like, on target onto me fast enough, I can just E before I die. Because it takes four of the shots of his right-click to kill Tracer now. And
that's true.
It takes, I think, all six to kill Genji, right?
Each shot does 45, so...
Yeah. Or no, it takes five. It takes five. So,
They're not stunned long enough to land all six.
No.
So.
Yeah, but it would take five, which is hard to do, honestly. You have to be, like, really fast with that.
Yeah, and you have to hit the shots.
You have to hit every shot, yep. It's not the most accurate thing. I think, okay, if you're out there trying to play McCree, I'm not a McCree god by any means. I've got, like, an hour played on McCree. I don't enjoy the character, really, in general. But I think, my unprofessional opinion, the play might be to stun and then get the guaranteed headshot, like your Mei, and then maybe go for, like, headshot melee or headshot right click or something.
That's probably the play.
Similar to, like, how Mei does things. Mei rolls. Mei the Bay.
It's just a lot harder than the old combo, so
absolutely, it takes
to.
a lot more skill. But I think that's the point, right? Because old McCree was so brain dead.
It's true.
Yeah. But Genji is not brain dead, and Genji is strong right now. Although, I would like to comment on his play percent if you look at the data. It's not super high. Just keep in mind, Genji is really, really hard to play, and not every team has a player talented enough to play him at the level that people like Seagull are playing him. So his play rate is naturally not going to be the highest. But play rate is not completely indicative of power, like, strength in the meta. It is definitely a good barometer, but it's not, you know, the end-all be-all. So Genji, do not be fooled by the play percentage. He is very strong right now. And if you love Genji, practice him, because you will become very, very valuable to have on a team when competitive comes out.
Definitely.
Yeah, very valuable going forward.
Yep. Who do we want to talk about next?
How about Tracer and Zenyatta?
Oh, I want to save Tracer for later, but...
150 health characters.
Yeah, Zenyatta... His play percentage is still ridiculously low, but do we think he's gotten stronger?
He's gotten a little stronger, but I feel like even with, like, the rise of Roadhog, like,
we'll talk about that
being a possible answer to him, feel like he hasn't gotten as strong as I may have expected when I initially read the patch notes.
Yeah.
I've actually read a little bit when I was at work on break today, just browsing on the internet, that, like, some high-level teams are actually practicing Zenyatta comps, and they just haven't whipped them out in tournament yet. I don't know, like, if that means anything, but I did read that, so. Hopefully we see that soon. I'd love to see Envious play some Zen and Yada comp or something, or Cloud9 play some Six and Yada comp. But we'll see.
Yeah, it'd be fun to see.
Yeah. I mean, he definitely has the kit, you know? He's got the damage to be good, and he's got good healing, good ult, so.
Yeah.
I feel like now's the time, too. Like.
Now's the time, yep. Now is definitely the time. I want to talk about Roadhog. I think we should go to Roadhog next, because...
Oh, I got a lot to say.
So do I, okay? Roadhog, I think the reason that Roadhog has gotten strong is... Partially, like you said, Alex, he's a tank killer. But it's not even that he's just a tank killer. Is he fills that role that McCree left so well. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, when you think about McCree's abilities, McCree has a stun. He has insane high burst at very close range. Like, what does Roadhog have? He's got a stun. He has insane high burst at really close range. Like, destroys tanks, destroys squishies if he lands his CC. Like, you know what I mean? He's almost the new McCree.
He essentially has a flashbang that's like 5 times as long.
Yeah, 5 times as long, but you have to actually be a god to hit. Well, not quite a god, because the hitbox is enormous, but you have to be pretty skilled to hit it on like fast-moving targets and stuff. Yeah, and he brings a lot to the table. He brings 600 health. He brings 300 health like heal that is really fast to activate and on a short cooldown. His shift is actually on a shorter cooldown than McCree's E, which is something interesting. And he can one-shot Tracer with both his left click and his right click. So that's cool. Yeah, Roadhog's a beast, dude.
He's really... Because, like, now that... I actually feel like people are struggling to find, like, a good answer to him now. Because, like, McCree was, like, the answer to everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Especially Roadhog. And now... It feels like it's hard to do enough damage to him before he just runs away and heals himself.
Yeah, like, let's think about the cast right now. Like, who does well against Roadhog in a 1v1? Like, does Reaper?
Reaper does.
Does he really?
Reaper can out-damage him at close range.
Yeah. But Roadhog...
And Reaper's harder to hit.
Reaper is harder to hit. And Reaper's got shift if he gets hooked. And I feel like Roadhog can't kill Reaper in one hook combo. Correct me if I'm wrong on that.
Maybe with the melee, if he gets a headshot, he could.
He'd have to get like
if he does like the right click hook, left click.
Yeah, if
combo.
He does right click hook left click, he would. But that's a lot of shit to hit.
Yeah.
You know, like that's a tough combo to hit. So yeah, Reaper's decent. And speaking of Reaper, Reaper has gone up in play percentage a ton. I want to get to him soon, but. Like, who else really deals with Roadhog? Does Soldier deal with Roadhog well?
Soldier can just, like...
You can't really kill him.
He can hit him down, but then he can just run away and heal himself.
Yeah,
so I don't think Soldier's the
But
guy.
You can charge your ult off of him.
Yeah, definitely.
So that's the thing. Pharah does all right against him, but it's actually... If you're good with Roadhog, it's actually not that hard to hook Pharah.
Yeah.
It's really not. I think Alex can attest to that.
It's... Very true.
I've seen you hook a good many pharaohs in your day, and they die. You know, when you I mean, they can E if they live the first shot, they can E, but they're still gonna die. Like, and
it's
no,
also
what,
very hard to like, just like using like your clip of six rockets. You don't have enough damage to kill the guy. Like, he'll just E.
Yeah, he will.
And then you're kind of out of luck.
Yeah, and then if you land. Like if your fuel runs out and you have to land, he's probably gonna kill you. If he's close to you, but her E is pretty good in that matchup though. So, one thing we do have to remember about Roadhog is he has no mobility whatsoever. So,
very true.
Yeah.
I think Tracer fights Roadhog well. I'll say that. I think Tracer is good at fighting Roadhog.
Oh yeah. He gives so much ult.
So much ult. Yeah, like. Sometimes I'll just go into a fight with Roadhog with, like, almost no ult, and I'll fight him for a while, get my ult, kill him with my ult, and then just move on. Like, you know what I mean? It's like,
yeah.
We can just pretend that I never got that ult, but I killed you without it. Yeah, Junkrat fights Roadhog pretty well, so that might be something.
I feel like it's the same issue with Pharah, honestly. Like, you have to land a lot of shots.
Yeah, but
over
he's fat.
A long time.
He's big. You know what
but
I mean?
But he can just eat, and, like,
yeah.
Junkrat only has a 5 clip.
That's
yeah,
true.
That's true.
What if he E's and you throw the trap below him while he's E'ing?
He'll just get knocked up in the air while eating.
No. Yeah. The you throw Junkrat's E, the snare.
Oh.
Does he get trapped?
Yeah, he does.
If you just throw it while he's eating.
Yeah.
That'd be like a sick outplay. I'd love to see some video of that, like where Junkrat just fights a Roadhog and then Roadhog eats and then Junkrat just throws the snare below him and he's like, "Oh, I just finished eating," and you're just gonna snare your boy like that.
From personal experience, having attempted that before, it usually ends with a hook and a head full of bullets.
Yeah. You definitely can't push your luck against Roadhog trying to get as much damage as possible on him while he's eating. That's something that I've been killed for a lot on Tracer, where it's like, oh, I'm just going to stand right in front of his face and headshot him a bunch of times while he's eating, and then I'll E away, it'll be so sick, and then I, like, don't E. Like, I'm like, oh, just a couple more bullets, just a little more ult charge, and then he just, boom, one-shots me. Like,
I know that feeling pretty well.
So, Roadhog is definitely strong right now. I wouldn't say he's, like, overbearing. I don't think... Do you think he is? Either of you?
I don't think so. Yeah, he's not, like, the old McCree level. Any means.
But he is seen on almost every competitive team right now.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think, Matt, you place a lot of value in Roadhog right now, don't you?
Yeah.
I think, yeah, he's definitely no McCree, but he definitely deserves the praise that he's been getting. He's pretty strong. But I think we can move on from Roadhog. One thing I would like to say about Roadhog, if you guys are out there like thinking about playing competitive in the future, don't think of Roadhog like a tank, because he's not, you know.
Yeah.
Roadhog should fill the position that a McCree used to fill, or, well, not necessarily, but he fills an aspect of what McCree used to do. He does not fill the aspect, he does not, like, fill the role of a Reinhardt. Like, don't think that you can go into a game with just Roadhog as your tank and you're on offense. Like, that is going to end horribly for you. Do not do it.
Mm-hmm.
If you're playing Roadhog,
provides,
you...
like, sustained DPS
and,
like, pick potential.
Yep. But... if you're playing Roadhog, you at least need Zarya on there with you.
For sure.
Which Roadhog-Zarya is a super strong combo. Which, maybe, do you want to just move on to Zarya next?
Yeah, we could do the tank meta right
now.
Okay, yeah, let's just stick with tanks then. We'll keep it, we'll go through like that. Go from right to left, I guess. Or whatever, we're starting with tanks, but whatever. Zarya, how do we feel about Zarya right now? Because she's going up in play percentage, I believe.
Yeah.
She is
one of the most damaging tanks in the game.
Absolutely.
Alongside Roadhog.
Yeah.
And you see them a lot paired together, Roadhog Zarya comps.
Yeah.
Or Roadhog Winston on King of the Hill.
Mm-hmm. Even Roadhog Zarya Reinhardt's
good. Or Zarya. Zarya Winston, I mean.
Yeah. Even Zarya Reinhardt's good too. I think Zarya's probably the best tank right now. In my opinion, I know Reinhardt has a much higher play percentage than her, but I think I can comment on that when we get to him later. How do you guys feel about that? That statement that I just made?
She's definitely up there in one of the top tanks.
Yeah.
She might be like the top offense tank.
Top offense tank.
Top defense tank.
Yeah, I think that is definitely a good distinction to make. There's even some data on that for offense and defense. Too, which maybe I can take a look at later. But, Zarya, just one of the best ults in the game, right? Like, absolutely.
Definitely.
Absolutely a godlike ult. She's actually, this is kind of interesting, she has played, so, the only character that has more, like, a more polarizing offense-to-defense ratio than Zarya was Widowmaker, but it was very slight. So, Zarya is almost purely seen on offense. And then Symmetra is only picked on defense. And same for Junkrat, I believe, is almost always picked on defense, too. He's 360% more on defense than offense. Zarya is 243% more on offense than defense, though, which is really high. Any idea why that is?
It's largely because of her ult having, like, a higher value on offense than defense. Because, like, you're not trying to, like, make pushes and get, like, these big team fights while you're trying to defend a point.
Also, her E and her shift are really good for pushing, too. Definitely. You know what I mean? You just need to get someone in there to crack the base. So.
And she's really good against Roadhog. She can save people who get hooked.
She can save people who get hooked, yeah. She's also good against Reinhardt. She can save people who get shifted by Reinhardt.
So important.
Yeah, it's super useful. I mean, she used to be... She can do the same thing with McCree. You can save people from McCree. Not that he's as dominant anymore, but he's still seen, so it's still relevant. things like that. So, one other thing about Zarya is she can essentially nullify two people in any team fight from a big ult. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, four people are grouped up, Reaper drops in the middle of them and ults. Zarya can save two of them. Now Reaper only got a two-man ult. Like, that's huge, dude. That's, you're cutting the efficiency of Reaper's ult by 50%.
Yeah, definitely.
As well as
with only your shift and your E.
Zarya
was, yeah, and stacking Zarya up, and you don't even need to use a big cooldown for it. I mean, her shift and E are pretty long cooldowns, but it's not like an ult. You know?
Yeah.
So, like, that's so big. Just, she's really good right now. If you like playing Zarya, you're in a good spot right now. You've been in a good spot for a while, though. I think she's been strong for a while. It's just, she's pretty tough to play, and she's finally starting to get the recognition she deserves.
Definitely.
She's definitely, like, a cognitive hero. So
We are seeing a lot less Winston, though.
Yeah, Winston fell hard. Winston used to be in argument for the best tank, and he's still seen. Like, his play rate is really boosted by the fact that he's
King of the Hill still.
King, but he is, like, yeah, he's definitely a badass on King of the Hill.
He just doesn't have anyone to dive on anymore.
Well, another thing that I think is a big deal is that one hero limit kind of killed Winston.
True.
In my opinion. Because the double Winston comp, like, having two Winstons is so much better than having one Winston. Even more so than, I guess, the sum of its parts, if you want to word it like that. Just because two Winstons jumping on a 200 health character will insta-kill them. Well, one Winston jumping on a 100 health character, like, there's a lot of counterplay there. You just kill him back. He doesn't do much damage. But two Winstons, like, you're going to die immediately. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So.
I think it's important to note, too, that, like, with the one hero limit, as much as it's, like, killed Winston, it's kind of brought Mercy to an even higher rate of power.
It has absolutely brought Mercy to an even higher rate of power. And I think we'll talk about her in a second, but her play rate is absurd right now. It's been absurd for a while, though. She's the only hero above 80% usage right now. She's in a tier of her own.
Crazy.
Yeah. And let me see if it went up or down since last patch. It actually went down by about 5%, so very slightly. But still, she's played a ton.
Reinhardt seems to still be in the same spot.
Yeah,
as it was.
See, I think that Reinhardt just fills such a unique role that is almost irreplaceable in the situations where it's needed, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
You know? So it's like, even if they nerf Reinhardt, he's still going to be played in the situations where he's needed. Like, he's just... And he's needed in a lot of situations. I'm not trying to make it sound like he's some niche character. He fills a really important role, and he's the only character in the game that fills that role, bar none. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Winston Shield is nothing compared to what Reinhardt Shield can do. Yep. So, I mean, Reinhardt's just a really simple champ. Really simple champ who does one job, and he does it really, really fucking well.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah, he does.
So, you know.
D.Va's getting played a lot more, though.
Mm-hmm. One thing I would like to say about Reinhardt is, do you guys think they should nerf him? I was thinking about this at work today. Do you think they should nerf Reinhardt?
Until they, if they, like, create another character that can, like, occupy a similar role as Reinhardt, I don't think they should.
Yeah, me too.
You agree? Okay. I also agree with you, but I will say if they do nerf him, one thing that they, the one nerf that they should do, if they do, is decrease the recharge rate on his shield. Because it seems like it comes up after breaking or after getting damaged a lot, like, really, really damn fast. I don't play Reinhardt a lot, but doesn't it feel like that?
It does come up really fast.
So, I don't know. I don't think they should nerf him either, though. He's played a lot, but that's just because he's the only guy who can do what he does. And what he does is necessary. So.
Yeah.
But yeah, D.Va's been getting played more. I think she was in the F tier last week, and she is in D tier this week, so she's making progress.
Oh, baby!
Baby girl's moving up in the world. She's raising her APM as well as her play percentage. Which is exactly what I like to see. I've been playing tons of D.Va. I love D.Va. I always play tons of D.Va. I don't give a damn if she's good, bad, or ugly. Not that she is, but I love D.Va. Love raising the APM, so. And I think, I don't know, I had a couple great games on D.Va this week, but. I mean, I'm a D.Va fucking god, so, like, what does that mean? No. Do you think D.Va's stronger for any particular reason?
There's the new comp that we've seen since the new patch.
Yeah. Do you want to talk about that now or save it? I guess, yeah, mention it briefly.
It's like a rush the base kind of comp.
Yeah.
It has
Genji and who else
Genji,
is in it?
Genji, Tracer, D.Va, and Winston, I think.
Yep, and then the supports.
Along with Mercy and Lucio.
Yeah. That's such an interesting comp, because it's like, that is hyper-aggression, like, to the word, you know what I mean? Like, to the definition.
Yeah, definitely.
It's insane.
They play it on capture point maps, the first point, and then payload. They switch off before the payload, though.
That makes sense, yeah. That comp is not good at escorting a payload, but it is definitely good at swarming the fucking base, like Zerg rushing you.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that sounds like a really fun comp. I'd love to play that comp with you guys, like, tonight when we play or something.
I would too, honestly.
Really fun. Like, plus Genji, like, who's in that comp? Genji, Tracer, D.Va, Winston. Like, I'm a Tracer main, Alex is a Genji main. Like, that's fucking perfect.
And I feel like this is another instance of a one hero limit creating, like, interesting and diverse team comps that we might not have seen before.
Yeah, because this team comp reminds me a lot of the old double Winston, double Tracer, double Lucio comp, or the people would do, like, double Winston, double McCree, double Lucio, or Lucio Mercy, whatever. There's a lot of variations to it, but that was, like, what was seen on payload a lot. And this seems like the poor man's version of that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Which is cool, because this is a lot more interesting than seeing two monkeys and two cowboys running around every single game. Yeah. Is that... We covered all the tanks there, right?
Yeah, we did.
One thing I would like to say is that of all the tanks, the tank that rose the most in play percentage was Roadhog by... He went up about 18%, so that's pretty high. That's a pretty good raise. And D.Va went up about 9%, so that's also pretty solid, considering she was at less than 5% play rate before.
And
now she's at, like, a healthy, what? She's at, like, a healthy 12 or something, so.
You know how much Winston went down?
Winston? Okay, yeah, we can talk about who went down. Reinhardt went down only, like, 2%, pretty much irrelevant. Winston went down 15%. That's a lot. He went down the most of any tank. He's the only tank that actually went down a significant amount, because Reinhardt pretty much stayed the same. So basically, he's the only tank that lost play percentage this patch. Every other one went up, which is something we touched on last week, is that tanks are going to get played more. And they are, except Winston.
So, I feel like this is, like, two things are going on here. It's like, one is, like, the rise of Roadhog, and Roadhog just naturally being good against Winston.
Very good against Winston. Roadhog used to be played in very rare situations to deal with the double Winston comp. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do.
That was a month ago or so, but yeah. Anyway, go on.
And then the second is the point we've touched on already, is the one hero limit making Winston a lot weaker.
Also, Widowmaker losing 60% of her play percentage. Like, Widowmaker was one of the biggest reasons you picked Winston. Right? You just jump on her and hold left click, and you can usually kill her before she gets away. Or at least force her to move.
Especially with two.
Or if you have your own Widow. Interrupting the Widow duel is such a big advantage for the Widow that gets interrupted, you know?
And then they can focus on, like, healers.
Yep.
Keep targets again.
Yeah. So, that's that. Most tanks went up, Winston went down. That's the TLDR. Let's talk about... You want to go to supports next, or do you want to talk about like more DPS characters?
We can go to supports.
Yeah,
the support meta, it didn't really change
did not
much
change
at
much
all.
At all. Nope. Mercy. So Mercy's play percentage went down by about 3-ish% or something. Almost irrelevant. Literally irrelevant, actually, I would say. I would call that irrelevant. Almost unexplainable there, but
yeah,
she is still above 80%. She is sitting at a total of it looks like about 90, actually. Looking at this graph, it's around like 86 to 90% probably. So that's crazy, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Like, that's insane. That's for overall usage too. That includes King of the Hill defense and offense. I think we talked about last week. We think that her ult should get nerfed a little bit, but I don't know. What are your thoughts on Mercy? Is she overpowered, or why is she so used so much?
I think she's really strong pretty much because of her ult.
You think so?
Yeah, I think she's really balanced. Like, her healing and damage boost is really balanced. But her ult just comes up so fast. If you are healing a tank that is low, you can get your ult up like 60 or 70% off one
absolutely.
Tank.
Especially like a Roadhog with 600 health.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, I actually disagree with you on this a little bit. I think the reason that Mercy is played so damn much is just because, well, one, Lucio has fallen out a little bit with the one hero limit thing a little bit, but mainly because there is no other character that is a pure healer in the game. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's true.
And, like, you need one.
Yeah, you do.
It's the same thing with Reinhardt. You just need him, and there's no one else that does what he does.
Yeah. So.
That's a very good point, actually. Even, like, considering, like, the power of her ult.
Yeah, I do think her ult needs a nerf. I'm not saying her ult doesn't need a nerf. It does. But I think the reason for her play percent, like, she could literally heal, like, probably 75% as fast as she heals, and they could remove her damage boost completely, and I still think her play rate, she would be the most played character in the game, in my opinion. So.
I think they'll be.
That might be a bit of a hyperbole, but I think my point, I think that you feel my point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Enough about Mercy. Lucio, let's see what happened to Lucio. Oh, damn, Lucio went down by 15%. Any idea why that is?
They just recently and really enforced the one hero limit rule.
And I was telling you guys this last night, too. Lucio is similar to Winston. Funny enough, Winston went down 15% and Lucio went down 14%. They're really similar to each other in the sense that two Lucios are greater than the sum of their parts, but now that you can't have two Lucios, having one Lucio is good, but it's not as good as it used to be.
Definitely.
By no means a bad character, though, right? Like.
Yeah, he's still really good. He is the best in the game.
Yeah, he's the second most played character, you know?
Yeah.
I believe. Let me look at this. No, third most. For overall usage, he's the third most by very, very, very close with Reinhardt. But, yeah, he's still great. But he's going down. He's on the decline. And then Symmetra. Can we even call Symmetra support? Like, Symmetra's not a support. She went down.
I'm very, very biased. I'll fight for her support tag.
Yeah, you will. You were fighting with us last night about this. we had a bit of a conversation about the utility of Symmetra's ultimate and how it compares to Mercy Rez, but she's in the similar spot that she was last week. She went down by about 10%, but that's fairly negligible. One thing I would like to mention about Symmetra, if you guys are just looking at the numbers, one thing that you should keep in mind, just looking at the raw data, is that the reason that Symmetra's play percentage is not super, super high is because she's only played on defense, and she's only played at the first point of the first point of payload maps, basically.
Yeah, so, the capture point of the payload
capture
maps.
Yeah, the capture point of the capture, then payload. So, naturally, her play rate's not going to be that high because she's only used in this one specific niche. But that does not mean that she is not extremely strong at that one thing that she does. So,
yeah,
something to keep in mind.
Also, one of the reasons why her win percentage went down about 10% is because with the Widowmaker nerfs, Torbjorn has been played a lot more.
Yeah, that's true. And Torbjorn fills a similar role to her, although not entirely the same. He did go up. Actually, Torbjorn stayed around the same, but I've definitely been seeing him.
Yeah, I've seen him quite a bit more, actually.
Yeah.
Like, and generally, from what I've seen from competitive games, is I don't see a Symmetra and a Torbjorn on the same team.
Absolutely.
It's usually
not
one or the other.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No, if you have Symmetra and Torbjorn on your team, you're investing too much in like that static defense type character, you know?
Yeah.
How do you guys feel about Symmetra in general? Do we like Symmetra? Do we think she's healthy, in a healthy spot? Because I don't know if I do, but maybe. What do you guys think, though?
I think she's in a pretty healthy spot. Like, she's strong at controlling choke points.
Very strong at what she does.
And she creates like a revolving door of like characters, like,
yeah,
that die and they come back. And I don't know, I feel like she's in a pretty good spot, honestly.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's in a pretty good spot, I guess. She's very polarizing character in the sense that she does one thing very well and nothing else well at all. If we look at her play percentage, she was played only on defense, never on offense, and never on King of the Hill. But her play percent on defense is over 50%, so that's pretty good. Over half the times on defense she's played. Never on King of the Hill, though. Is there anybody here who knows anything about, like, King of the Hill Symmetra, maybe? Like,
I wonder.
The legendary, maybe heard whispers of the King of the Hill Symmetra coming through and dominating games.
I've been playing King of the Hill Symmetra quite a bit, actually.
Quite a bit. You have been playing King of the Hill Symmetra so much that I am now convinced that it's good. And I was not when you started, because I was shit-talking you a lot when you first... I was like, why the hell is Matt... Like, you would be like... You're like, all right, I'm going to pick everyone's, like, characters. You know, Ryan, you go Tracer. Alex, you go Reaper. Like, we're going to have this sick team comp. And me, Symmetra. And I'm like, what the hell is wrong with you, you asshole? Like... But I don't know.
Hey, but it works.
No, you've made it work. You've actually developed a playstyle for King of the Hill Symmetra somehow, so...
It is a little bit different than the defensive playstyle.
Yeah, for sure.
A little bit different.
It's a lot different.
I pretty much...
I can't co-sign on it being good, by the way. I'm co-signing it on it being decent. I just want to say that. But go on.
It's just... I just stand by tanks and hold right click.
That's actually amazing. I love that.
Once you do get the point, once you do get the point, it's really hard to give up.
It's really impressive. Yeah, she's really impressive if you capture the point, and you're just holding it with Symmetra. So there's that. Although in competitive play, she's not played on.
Yeah, there's no way it would work. High level play.
No, but if you're a daring soul out there, maybe you can take up the gauntlet that Matt has laid down and try to follow in his footsteps as the King of Hill Symmetra master. I also find it really funny, Matt, that you don't play Symmetra at all, except on King of the Hill. Like, she is so damn strong at defense, you're like, and we get to defense, you're like, I don't want to play Symmetra. And then King of the Hill rolls around, you're like, let's fucking go, Symmetra. So that's that's really funny. I think she's in a pretty healthy spot right now, though. She doesn't need any kind of nerfs or anything like that.
Yeah. And we briefly touched on Zenyatta.
Yeah, earlier. We touched on Zenyatta earlier, so we're good there. Let's see, who else? I guess we can move on to, like, offense heroes.
Reaper has been played a lot more.
Yeah, so the offense hero who dropped the most, obviously, was McCree. He dropped 31%. But Reaper... gained about 25%, actually, which is the highest growth of any character. He is actually the highest offense character, the most played offense character in the game right now. How do you guys feel about Reaper?
He's a great source of sustained damage. Like, you can't pass up on how quickly he destroys Reinhardt's shields, how quickly he destroys tanks, how he can, like, one-shot a Tracer with a headshot. Like, he has a lot of things going for him.
Yeah. One thing, you were talking about this, Matt, last night. You don't think that Reaper is meant to be played as, like, an assassin or a backline flanker, right?
No, definitely not. There is every once in a while where he does go for the alt flank.
Yeah.
But he's mainly seen on the front line along with Reinhardt and Soldier.
Mm-hmm. And one thing that I want to say as somebody who plays a lot of Reaper and someone who plays a lot of Zarya, Reaper-Zarya is a godlike combo. That Definitely. Is such a strong combination of characters. Everything about those two characters synergizes so damn well with each other. It's insane. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you can't go wrong.
Yeah, she shields him. So he becomes invulnerable, goes in, does a hell of a lot of damage. His shield runs out. He does a little more damage, gets low, shifts away. Pretty soon, the Zarya shields back up. He goes back in. Like, you know what I mean? And then, oh, look, we both got ult. Zarya ults four people. Reaper presses Q. They all die instantly. So... yeah, those characters synergize really well together. That's definitely a comp that has been getting some buzz, some talk. I've seen here and there. Not here and there, it's been getting played a ton. He's most played offense character right now. Zarya Reaper, very strong.
He's played in King of the Hill too. That's also why.
He is a god on King of the Hill, for sure. Yeah. He's actually played evenly on King of the Hill in offense and slightly less on defense, but still a lot on defense.
Yeah.
Pretty impressive, actually.
Yeah.
So, it's an interesting statistic.
Yeah. Reaper, if he has a little bit of support, like from Azaria or like a Torbjorn giving him armor or something like that, or a Mercy healing him constantly, he can be such a devastating frontline fighter, you know?
Yeah.
And that's how you got to use him. In pubs, you can definitely be the flanking, sneaking up on rooftops, teleporting like 2 inches behind people, guy. Like, you can do that stupid stuff. If you want to
be that guy,
you can be that guy, because it kind of works in pubs sometimes, because not everybody has a headset and not everybody listens.
Yeah.
But if you're playing against competent players and you press E on Reaper and try to like E behind somebody, you're just gonna hear death comms like echoing through your
shadow.
Yeah, or whatever the hell he says, like through your astros, just boom. You're like, holy shit, there's a Reaper right behind me. And you just turn around and insta kill him. So yeah, not the best play there, but what are you going to say, Alex?
An important tip for aspiring Reaper players is, like, if you're going for, like, the big alt flank, just crouch.
Yeah.
Crouch walk.
Yeah.
Make yourself quieter, and
that'll
have a big impact on who notices you.
It's not, you're still not silent when you crouch walk, but it is a lot, it is quieter, yeah. And don't teleport in plain sight ever, please. I see this happen a lot in pubs, where, like, especially with, like, you notice it more when you're playing Widow.
With any Widow or Hanzo, you're dead.
Yeah. Not even that. Like, dude, I can kill Reaper with Tracer before he's done with his E animation. Like,
yeah, his headshots.
Yeah, you just aim at the head. Yeah.
Just, like, stuck there for 2 seconds.
He's stuck there for, a good second. Like, just from the shadow. So. But Reaper is super strong if you play him correctly. And he's also a noob stomper. He's a noob stomper and a pro stomper. He's just a stomper. So if you want to learn a character, like if you're maybe you're like newer at the game and you want to learn a character that is not only good at a low level but also good at a high level, like unlike somebody like Torbjorn who's only good at a low level mostly, pick Reaper because he's good at all levels.
True.
And he's fucking fun as hell, dude. He is such a fun guy. Like, you just play the games.
I love playing.
Yeah, he is so damn fun. The plays that you can make with his ult and are just so satisfying.
Yeah.
And then you gotta make sure to equip a cool spray when you play Reaper, because you're gonna get lots of play of the games. So you have to put your spray down after you ult.
Yeah, you need to let the enemy team know that it's tea time.
Yeah, you gotta let them know it's tea time. Or that you oopsed. If you got the oops spray. If you got 50 unlocks for someone, you gotta use that oops. Anyway, the next highest offense character on the tier list is actually McCree, and we talked about him plenty. So McCree is still in a pretty healthy spot. His play rate is sitting at literally like a dead even 50. So good job, McCree.
That was Soldier.
Yeah, Soldier is actually just about even with him. So how do we feel about Soldier? He's pretty good right now.
Yeah, he's actually gone up, hasn't he?
He has... Yeah.
The McCree nerf's like kind of...
Yeah, he's actually the second... He's the second highest boost. He's gone up by about 22%. Yeah, I think it's a combination of the Widow and the McCree nerfs. Maybe the Widow nerfs even more, because Widow is frustrating for Soldier for a couple of reasons. One, because you can't fight her at your most effective range. You can't fight her pre-batch, which is annoying. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, this is what Soldier is supposed to be best at, but I still can't fight Widow, which is, this is not even what she's best at, is mid-range. But you still really can't fight a good Widow at mid-range with Soldier. Because your E becomes irrelevant if she headshots you.
Yeah.
So that's annoying, and also McCree just being nerfed, people needing another long-range sustained damage type guy. Soldier is the epitome of sustained damage accurate. He's hit scan, you know. What more could you want?
It's important to note that, like, both McCree and Widowmaker were kind of played as like the DPS characters of the team.
Yeah.
So that's like also why we're seeing like Roadhog come up along with Soldier and Reaper. It's like we need new DPS characters.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, and for Soldier in specific, Widowmaker and McCree, they're both medium to long range, generally, except for McCree had crazy close range damage too. But medium long range, hit scan DPS, and Soldier, he is a medium long range hit scan DPS. So
yeah,
they get nerfed. He comes up. It's pretty simple. He's definitely good right now though.
Yeah, definitely.
We all play him. We all like him, right?
Yeah,
I'm a fan of him.
He definitely doesn't need a nerf, even though he has a pretty high play rate. I do not want to see him get nerfed. I don't think. I don't know about how you guys feel about that.
He's like a pillar, I feel like.
Yeah, he is.
Of all the characters.
Yeah, I feel like if everybody could be as balanced as Soldier, this game would be perfectly well balanced.
Yeah.
So, not a whole lot more to say there. He's good. Play him.
Just do it.
Yeah, just do it, dude. Next on the list, we got Pharah. And I think that Pharah is really strong. I think she's stronger than what this shows, personally.
She's really, really strong right now.
Mm-hmm.
She's seen a lot more play. Even with the Rise of Soldiers, she's still seeing a lot more play.
Even, not even in competitive, too. Like, Pharah is everywhere in pubs now.
Yeah. You know?
Everyone's picking up Pharah. So, I don't know. What makes her biggest counter got nerfed, right? Widow?
Yeah, Widow.
Yeah.
So, that's a big thing for her. I mean, who in the meta really challenges Pharah as much as Widow and Hanzo, who aren't really played that much anymore? Soldiers, but
Soldier does.
Yep.
Soldier and Roadhog.
Roadhog and Hooker, true.
I feel like that Roadhog is actually one of the reasons she's not as high as she might have been.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You guys might be familiar with the Zarya Pharah Mercy comp, which was really strong a couple weeks ago and is probably even stronger now, actually. I would be willing to bet good money that that comp is really, really strong right now. With all three, or both of those champions, Zarya and Pharah, going up in usage and just general strength.
Yeah, you just put a shield on Pharah.
Yeah, you put a shield on Pharah so she can't get hooked, she can't get sniped, and she ults. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can't go wrong with that.
Can't go wrong with that. Plus,
her ult synergizes really well with Zarya's ult.
Absolutely. Even if Pharah doesn't have ult, she's still really good at following up on Zarya ult too. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
She's one of those kinds.
With her AoE damage.
Just AoE, yeah. So Pharah's really, really good right now if you can play her, which she's not too hard to play, honestly. She's got some cool... What's that?
Easy to pick up, but like hard to master.
Yeah, she's hard to master because she's got like a lot of little nuances with like her E and like how to maximize her fuel and stuff like that.
And positioning.
Positioning.
Yep. Really crucial.
And knowing when to ult and who to target first with your ult, too, is big. But she's still pretty easy to pick up at like lower levels, and she's really damn fun. You know, you've got a missile launcher and a jetpack. Like,
you can't go wrong with
that. Can't go wrong with that at all. So that includes, I guess, like the best. That would be like those four are kind of like the top tier of the DPS characters. Like those are the four most played DPS characters. They're all sitting at about 50-ish%. Pharah's at like 48%. And the other two are at about 50 or slightly higher. And then below that, the next highest one on the list is my homegirl, my baby boo, my day one main, and I'll never stop maining this beautiful, beautiful Brit, Tracer. Let's see what's happened to the homegirl. Cheers, love. We went up by 15%. Nice. She's actually...
That's what we like to see.
Yeah, she went up by... she's the fourth highest growth of any character. So that's good, right?
Yeah.
I guess I'll start asking you guys, how much stronger do you think Tracer is in this meta?
She has definitely gotten stronger. We've seen her in... she's the third highest in King of the Hill, but now we're seeing her even...
Well, the King of the Hill thing... Yeah, the King of the Hill thing, she's always been... She has always been, like...
Really strong.
The goddess of King of the Hill. But yeah, now she's getting played elsewhere.
Yeah. We've seen her on offense and defense, actually.
Yeah. Let me make sure I am correct on this information before I say this. Okay. I want to ask Alex a question, which he should know the answer to, because he's my friend. And he's heard me talk before. Alex.
Play it on me.
Is Tracer better on offense or defense?
He's better on defense.
Hell yeah, she is. I'm always saying this. I'm always saying this. Tracer is better on defense than offense, even though she's titled as an offense character. Tracer is best on defense, and the data proves it. The data shows that Tracer is more more used on defense, although she's good on both. So play Tracer on defense because she is a god on defense. She's super annoying. I've been playing tons and tons of Tracer. I play Tracer. Got like almost 60 hours on her now, actually, or more than that, I think, if you include beta. I love Tracer, and I definitely think that she's a lot stronger right now. I love complaining about Tracer, so I'll probably still complain about Tracer all the time, because it's like just one of my hobbies these days, you know. But
old habits die hard.
Old habits die hard, man. But Tracer also dies hard, or is hard to die, hard to kill, and that's why she's good. We lost the game last night because we could not kill the enemy Tracer with all six of us. You remember that?
Yeah.
I remember that.
Yeah.
I just ran around
King's
the payload.
Yeah, we couldn't get her, and then her team caught up before we...
She stalled for, like, 20 seconds.
Yeah.
Which was insane.
And I have been that Tracer many, many times for you guys, so... Don't...
We appreciate the work you put on the front lines.
So, some things about Tracer, if I just want to, like, look at her matchups in, like, the top tiers, like, Tracer's really great at killing Mercy. This is one thing that I think Tracer has always been good at, is... Mercy has one dash that goes really, really far. So if you look at a character like Genji, like if you think about this, like sort of like how League works, when you try to assassinate someone, you need to have more gap closers than the person you're trying to assassinate by one, basically. You know what I mean? Like you need to have one gap closer to close the distance, and then one gap closer to catch up to them after they use theirs. So this is why Tracer's good at killing Mercy, because Mercy only has one, really. It's on a pretty short cooldown, but still it's one. You dash up to her, shoot her, she dashes away, you chase her. You know, Genji can't do that. Genji doesn't have that luxury. Really no other character in the game does, actually. So that's one thing that Tracer has going for her. With Mercy being the most played character, that helps. And young aspiring Tracer mains out there, one thing that you should do every game is press tab, and then look at the enemy team, and if you see the character named Mercy, you should look for them the entire game and kill them. And that's all you should do. And that is the only thing that you should focus on, because it's the most important thing.
Definitely.
Other characters up here in the top of the tiers, Reinhardt is really high. Tracer beasts on Reinhardt. She completely shits on Reinhardt, actually. I think she is one of the hardest counters in the game, Reinhardt, in my opinion. I don't know if you guys agree with that, but... She's not great against...
He doesn't have a lot of tools to deal with her. Like, I've been playing Tracer before when Reinhardt will just straight up ult for only me.
Yeah, totally. Because he gets so damn annoyed with... like, all Reinhardt can do against Tracer, if the Tracer's competent, is, like, do 180s and try to block you. You know what I mean? And just try to... Okay, I gotta shield my front. Oh, she's on my back. Shield my back. Oh, she's on my front. That's all he can really do. So, I mean, it takes you a while to kill him, but you also build a hell of a lot of ult off him.
Definitely.
Reaper... Tracer is good and bad against Reaper. For she can kite him, but she also dies instantly if she's out of position to him. McCree's decent against Tracer, but not nearly as good as he used to be. You can usually get away if he stuns you, unless the McCree's actually like decent. Soldier, Tracer's good against Soldier as long as you wait out his E. Pharah, same thing. She's good against Pharah if you wait out her shift. So Tracer does well in a lot of these matchups in the top tiers against other offense characters. So. Definitely think she's a lot stronger, and the Widowmaker nerfs and the McCree nerfs in particular just helped her so damn much. But I'm not going to rant about Tracer anymore, because I could talk about her for 5 more hours, honestly. Let's move on to... Yeah, we talked about Genji already, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that wraps up offense.
And the defense.
Yeah, you want to just wrap this show up with some talk about the defense characters. Like usual, defense characters are not very high on the usage list. Junkrat is the highest, though, which he has been for a while. How do you feel about Junkrat?
We still see him spamming choke points.
Still see him spamming away, dude.
He's still spamming choke points to this day.
Yeah. 15 years from now, we'll still hear the whisper of Junkrat, "Fire in the hole!" in every choke point. No, Junkrat, yeah, he does his job well, for sure.
Yeah, he does.
He's annoying. He's really annoying. I hate Junkrat. yeah, he kills Reinhardt's shield. Do we think he needs a nerf at all, or no?
I mean...
I think he's in a good spot.
He's okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Widowmaker's actually next up and the highest played.
Yeah, which is kind of embarrassing for the rest of the defense characters, actually. It's not impressive for Widow, because Widow dropped, what, 60% in her play rate?
And she's still
and
the
she's
second
the second
best.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, that just
that
shows
to, like, show she wasn't even like a defense character.
She's not. No. And if you look at the data too, she is played, where is this? Here. 250% more on offense than defense, which is another thing that I've said for a long time. Widow is better on defense than offense, in my opinion. And
yeah,
the pros
definitely.
Opinion. The pros opinion too, so yeah, we talked about Widowmaker to length already, so let's move on from her.
Wait, did you say on defense on offense, or...?
She's played way more on offense than defense, sorry. If I didn't say that, that's what I meant. Who's up next?
Bastion.
Yeah, Bastion is actually in...
a better spot.
He's in the D tier. Yeah, he is in the above 5% tier. Did he go up?
It.
Yeah, we made it, boys.
I think he did go up with the Widow nerfs.
Let me check this.
We're all Bastion mains.
We're all Bastion mains now. Bastion went up by about 10%, the same as D.Va. All right. Why is that? Widow?
Pretty much, I think only because of Widow. We actually have seen Bastion on offense.
Yeah, the death ball comp.
He sits on the payload. I've seen it in competitive. He sits on the payload with the Reinhardt.
Well, the old death ball comp used to be Bastion, Reinhardt, Double Widow, and Mercy Lucio.
Yeah.
But now they probably put soldiers there, and we got a new death ball rolling through, causing death and rolling around like a ball.
There's also the new Protect the President comp on King of the Hill with them.
What's that? Oh, really? Oh, that's right. On that's
pretty
not
much.
That's only played on like Lijiang Tower, though, right?
Yeah, but I've seen it played on two of the three Lijiang Tower maps, not just the one with the bridges.
Hmm. Interesting.
Well, the only one he's not played at is the Night Market one.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that map is such a such a cluster too. Like, so. I don't know. How do we feel about Bastion? Should they change Bastion at all? Should they rework him?
He's just
he's
no,
fine.
He's
fine.
In
a good spot.
Bastion is just Bastion. Bastion will always just be Bastion. It, like.
True.
Yeah. He's just fucking Bastion, dude. Like, whatever.
Everyone
who cares
says
about
they hate him.
Better than that, honestly.
Everyone says they hate him, but they secretly love him.
Bastion is like, I don't know. I'm trying to think of like a League character to change to compare Bastion to. He's like Teemo, kinda. You're like, he sucks, but he's bad. So what are you gonna do?
Like the old Nazahar.
No. Old Nazahar was broken as hell.
Well, he's like a noob stomper.
He was not a noob stomper. Old Nazahar got played in LCK. No. Old Nazahar got played in LCK last split. I am 100% serious. I'm serious, dude. Nazahar's busted. He's always been busted. He's been busted since day one that he came out. He's a stupid
Gotta buy that QSS.
You can't buy QSS on Ari. What the hell? Fuck you, Matt. Okay, I'll just buy myself a Mercurized Scimitar on Ari and do mad auto-attack damage. Fuck Malzahar. Okay,
May hasn't been played at all.
No, May. No. Can I talk about my new love? My new baby, oh. May.
Baby.
Baby May. Baby Maybe.
Maybe.
I've been on like a spiritual journey lately with May, where I've just been trying to find myself as a like a newfound man, as a May main. I used to think May was Cancer, but now I've just realized that she's my kind of Cancer. I love May.
I'm on a pilgrimage May.
To freeze people
and then find the source of the cancer.
You know, one thing I find really interesting about May is, okay, this is what May does. Like, she shoots you with ice until you are literally frozen solid. And, like, the characters are, like, chattering, like, until they're completely frozen. And then she puts her gun up to their temple and blows their brains out. Like, basically executes them. Like, literally just murders them. And then goes, ouch! Sorry! Like, what the hell, May? So.
All with that unblinking stare of hers.
Yeah, like, she's just speaking Chinese and saying sorry while she literally murders you. May's awesome.
This world is worth fighting for.
This world is worth fighting for. I guess so. I love May, man.
She might be like, awesome, but she's still not seen any play in competitive.
May, okay, yeah, May is like, she's a pretty poorly designed character in general. She's very exploitable by good players. You know, she's kind of like, I guess, I've been making League comparisons tonight, so I'll make one more. She's kind of like a Garen or a Darius, where you just gotta run away from her and you'll be fine. Like,
that's true.
But
that's a very good comparison, actually.
But god damn it, is she fun, though. You know what I mean? I don't know.
I think I have a 18% win ratio on her.
18? Mine's pretty high. Mine
after,
may...
like, 18 games.
My Mei win ratio is pretty high, I think. I'll check that later. It might not be high, because I lost, like, 6 more games today with Cobbles. Played all Mei.
Close.
But anyway, I love Mei. I don't think she'll ever be good. Maybe if they buff her a lot, but I don't think they should buff her, because then she'll just be annoying.
Yeah.
And I want to be, like... I don't know. I like Mei just being this really bad character that I play and love. So don't buff her, please, so she can be my low-tier hero. Hanzo.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about Hanzo.
Yeah, last week we said this was his chance, and it looks like he did not grasp at it.
He kind of did. He has... Me and Alex actually watched some live Overwatch today.
Well, what... Do you remember Overwatch, what tournament it was? Was it Ghost of Gamers?
It was the... Alienware monthly melee tournament.
Okay.
And he was seen attacking and defending on Hollywood for the first point and the streets phase. And he was also seen attacking on King Zero. On three different teams, actually.
Hmm. That's a lot. Yeah, that's a lot more Hanzo than, like, I've seen ever, almost.
We've seen it on Luminosity, Northern Gaming Red, and Envious.
Luminosity played it. Did Seagull play it?
No, it was not Seagull. It was Gods.
Oh, I love Gods.
Gods played it.
Gods is like...
He's a god.
If we're going to fanboy, I think Gods is my favorite player. Or Taimu. So, one of those two. I'm a big Gods fanboy. So, that's cool. Gods whipped out the Hanzo. Did it work? Did they win?
Yeah. No, they went 2-1 in their Division A. They lost to Envious, but they beat the other two teams.
Okay. Well, that's cool. Yeah, I think Hanzo is similar to Genji, similar to his bro. And Alex, I want you to talk about this a little more, because you're a lot more knowledgeable on both of these characters than I am, but Hanzo's just tough to play, man. Like, he's really, really damn hard to play.
They're both very, very difficult characters, so, like, it's hard to find, like, good representatives and, like of all the players who, like, will even play them at the highest level. And, like, even today, I only saw, like, one other Genji, one or two other Genjis besides Seagull.
Yeah.
And, like, they get success, but, like, I wasn't as impressed when I watched Seagull, but I'm a pretty big fan of them. But
yeah. Well, anyway, the thing is, like, you can't...
very hard.
Yeah. Well, I just want to say, you can't, like, because of Seagull alone, you have to acknowledge how strong Genji is. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. But go on.
Sure. And Hanzo is, like, in the same vein of, like, you have to find, like, a lot of shots.
Mm-hmm.
You have, like, no one to use your scatter arrow well. You know, like, get vision for your team well. Use your ult smart. He's just not someone that, like, he doesn't work in every team.
Not at all.
Genji also doesn't work in every team.
Not at all.
And he is very, like, inaccessible to a lot of people.
He is not easy whatsoever. I think they're the two toughest characters to play, so, in my opinion.
He was only played with Azaria, though. That's one thing to note.
Yeah, Hanzo Zarya is definitely... I would say, if we're just going to talk about the absolute best follow-up for Zarya ult, I think Hanzo might be number one.
You could do it from a safe distance.
Yep, and it goes through shields.
Definitely, yeah.
That's actually two incredibly important aspects.
Yeah. I think Bastion is also an amazing follow-up to Zarya if he's in position, but... Because he can just... not care about the shield and just destroy it instantly.
on this chart, it says in the F tier, it says Hanzo and Torbjørn, however you say his name.
Torbjørn, yeah.
Torbjørn. they say it's over-nerfed or useless in competitive format, and I don't agree with that.
Yeah,
I don't think Torbjørn or Hanzo.
Yeah, I think Hanzo is... he is, like, high effort, medium reward, can be high reward in, like, very specific situations. But, like, he's generally, like, he's, like, a high-risk, high-effort, medium-ish reward character. He's very sink or swim, Hanzo is, too. Like, I'm sure Alex can attest to this, like...
Oh, yeah?
You know, like, sometimes you just can't like get a second to breathe on Hanzo, and there's just constantly like Winstons and Genjis and Divas jumping on you, and you can't do anything against that. You know, he's just not equipped to deal with that.
Like, Widowmaker definitely better.
Widowmaker had the left click without zooming in.
And she also has her shift, which is infinitely better than Hanzo's wall climb escaping. Yeah. Just for pure escaping.
One thing we did see about Hanzo, though, is that in difference to Widowmaker, was never like by the team. She was always up above on a ledge by herself.
Yeah.
But Hanzo is always by the team in the front line, along with the Soldier and the Reaper and the...
Yeah, well, Hanzo does more sustained damage than Widow at medium range, for sure.
Yeah.
And also, Widow has a scope, so she can afford to play further back.
Yeah.
And she's hitscan.
True.
So, that's a big deal, I think. But Hanzo can definitely, pump out some DPS in like, a mid-range scenario, too. He's not, like, strictly a sniper, you know?
Yeah.
So that's one thing he's got going for him. Let's talk about Torbjorn. We saw him get played a bit, right?
Yeah, he's been played more now that Widowmaker has been nerfed.
Mm. Yeah, I've seen him more for sure.
It seems like it's more of a choice whether teams want to run Symmetra or Torbjorn now.
Yeah, I think Symmetra is better generally, but Torbjorn has a niche. He still has his little Torbjorn niche, and he can fill that.
They're played in the exact same scenarios, yep. Torbjorn and Symmetra.
First point of defense, yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Defense on the first capture point of capture point and payload maps.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, I don't know. Torbjorn, he's a goofy guy. Go like my Facebook page. The same picture of Torbjorn every day. No, but I mean, that wraps up all the heroes. We just went through everybody in a lot of detail.
Yeah, definitely.
We actually had more to talk about tonight, but I think we should cut it here.
I agree.
You wanna? Yeah, it's been over an hour, so.
Yeah, I think this is the dramatic conclusion.
So, is there any closing thoughts anyone has? Anything anyone want to say?
Still, just surprised how much the meta shifted from just two characters.
Yeah.
I don't mean to sound cocky, but I was kind of expecting, like, major shifts.
Really? Like, more than this?
No, like, about like this, like...
Oh, you, just, okay.
I felt like the game was, like, fragile, because, like, it's, like, a small...
No, that's not cocky.
It's pretty well balanced overall.
Yeah, it is, yeah, I would... Okay, let's give the patch our seal of approval. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah.
I approve,
although I am sad about Widow. So I have a stipulation to my seal, but I still am stamping.
You stamping?
I'm stamping. With a little sad face, with a little tear next to it, but I'm putting my John Hancock down there.
I guess the patch has the occupational meme seal of approval.
It does.
For what it's worth.
For what it's worth. One thing I do want to say is if you're listening to this, play Reaper, dude. I think lots of people should be playing Reaper and Pharaoh right now. Like, if you're just trying to pick strong characters, pick those assholes. And Roadhog, those three, actually.
And don't forget Soldier.
We're just listing everybody. Yeah, but Soldier, definitely, too. Well, all right, let's not get back into talking about more characters, because we already spent an hour on that. But yeah, this has been the Occupational Memers with Overtalks Episode 2, the patch 1.04 follow-up. Until next time, everybody, have a great day. And peace out.